covering maps of a circle.
Okay, thank you very much. So I think I'll try to start telling some stories about the Mellow. In fact, I'm not very good in telling stories, but I'll try. Okay? But before I start telling the story, let me make some comments here about things Wellington de Mello likes. And of course, maybe the first is Giusa, but after Giusa, of course, mathematics. It's here, mathematics. And about mathematics, of course, I was one of his students, and I learned a lot during that period here at IMPA, and profit a lot also from the atmosphere here, and have nice memories of this time. And of course, I learned a lot of one-dimensional dynamics, but many sort of other type of mathematics with him. But from time to time, he decided to teach a course in not different subjects, so, and it was nice. And also, now let me try to tell a story. There is this kind of folklore that Wellington likes boats. In fact, I think my conjecture here is a little bit different. I don't think Wellington likes boats. What I think he likes is, in fact, water. One tea, thank you. I think he likes water more than boat. And this is the reason, when he is not in the boat, it's rain all the time. So this is my conjecture here. So rain, this is the reason it rains a lot when he is here at the IMPA or in Salvador in a conference, and so it rains, okay? And in fact, here there is a story. Once I was with him in Angra, in his boat, very beautiful sunny day, very happy. But I think Wellington was not as happy as he would like to. And he decided, let's jump in the water. Okay? Let's jump in the water. Of course, there was a nice bar on the shore, and this was an excuse to jump in the water, but the water was more important, in fact. But and then I told him, I don't know how to swim. And of course, what he said, this is trivial. This is trivial. You just jump in the water and move your legs. So at this time, I start learning how to swim. So it's it was funny. Yeah, this is time. And of course, there is one thing here I know he also likes, which is dancing. Dancing he also likes. But this thing here, maybe it's better not to tell these stories because other boys could be. And two? Oh, sorry. So maybe not. Better not to tell these stories here because. Maybe Giusa can hear this story. But So let me try to talk now a little bit about mathematics. But before, let me not forget to thank the organizer for the invitation, the opportunity to talk here. And my talk today is about this, what I call, so it's absolutely continuous. So I will just write the initials, absolutely continuous invariant measure. This is for critical covering maps. Of the circle. And in fact, what I want to talk here is somehow a work in development. And I think most of the time I will try to be discussing ideas than proving theorems. So maybe at some point I will state a theorem and give some hints about his proof. But I'll try more to discuss ideas. So let me start saying what is this, the setup here. Okay. So this critical covering is just a map on the circle S1. So a map here. And I assume it to be C3 with negative Schwarzian. Okay. And of course here the word critical is just because you have one critical point. One critical point. I will denote by C. Okay. And moreover, I also make here a hypothesis, which is the following. You take the lift of the map, let's call it F, big F, and take modulus 1, modulus Z here. In fact, I identify this map with F again, okay? Just an abuse of notation, I'll denote it by F. And the hypothesis that I assume here that this guy is topologically conjugate to this map X goes to 2X mod Z. Okay. So topological type will be the same all the time. Okay, and of course, I want to focus on metrical properties, sometimes in geometrical properties, like absolutely continuous invariant measure, for example. Okay. Oh, of course, let me just make a drawing to have a visual image of this map. So this is the interval 0,1. Here's the diagonal. And then I see it like you have two branches here. And a critical point in here, I will denote by C. And then we have another branch here. So this is the map F. And I assume it is topologically conjugated to this linear map here, which is X goes to 2X mod Z. OK? There is here a topologically conjugacy. And let me start in this introduction telling something about this, the property which follows from this. Of course, the first property is just that F is what we call the topologically exact. So it means that if you take a small interval here after a finite number of iterations, it covers the whole circle. So, and this implies, of course, that there is also by, because of this hypothesis, you don't have a wandering intervals or you also don't have periodic points, periodic attractors. periodic attractors. We don't have this. And and in fact, you have a lot of periodic points, but all of them are Hippelian. This is periodic points are hyperbolic Hippelers. Okay, and they are of course dense and dense. This. Okay. And this is, of course, good from many point of view, but from the point of view, some point of view of rigidity, it's not very good. Because in general, it implies no C1 rigidity. Okay, so no C1 rigidity in general. Yeah. Although you have a lot of this is expansion, you have at least in the topological level, which is should be very nice for many aspects. For the aspect of C1 rigidity is bad because you have this many periodic points, and C1 conjugacy should preserve the eigenvalues, and of course it's not. I mean, in this case, most of the time is not possible. In fact, not possible because here the eigenvalues in periodic points is always power of 2. In fact, I also should mention here, because in general, this rigidity, people ask this rigidity in the case you have two maps with two, each map has a critical point. And sometimes you ask also something about the order of the critical point. Here is conjugated a map which has a critical point with a map without critical point. But still, you could expect some kind of rigidity. Not C1, but maybe some other kind of rigidity. Okay. Also, I would like to mention that, for example, in general, a tool to prove rigidity, as you saw in many talks here, prove as renormalization. Okay. And here, you don't have renormalization. No renormalization. So at least in the sense of Colette-Resserre and Feigenbaum, you have renormalization, but in a kind of generalized meaning. You need to consider renormalization if you want renormalization with more than one branch, at least two branches. And then there is, of course, work by Liubich in this direction and some other people. Okay. So it's still continue a little bit more with this introduction. Of course, here, the presence of this critical point, it works like a marked point on the circle. And the combinatorics of this point will play an important role. So then let me mention here that here you have many combinatorial behavior. So it means that if you take the itinerary of the critical point. In fact, here, most of the time, I will talk about the critical value. I will denote like this. This is just the image of C. The itinerary of this point, if you, for example, take this partition of the circle, put the symbol 0 here and 1 here, So it's a full shift in two symbols. And this itinerary here can be anything. Can be any theta in this full shifts. Okay. So many combinatorics, and the discussion today is a little bit concentrated in this direction. How this combinatorics has influence on the metrical and maybe sometimes in the geometrical properties of the map. Okay. Okay. And also, let me put some questions now, just to give you a direction where I can go, where I want to go. So, of course, one very natural question is about this kind of Lyapunov exponent here. Take the derivative of f to the power n on the critical value and ask if it goes to infinity or not. It's a question. Okay? And also, there is this something related with this, which is the property I mentioned in the beginning, the title, which is absolutely continuity. It's absolutely continuity. So you can phrase this as absolute continuity rigidity, if it holds. So it means that if this map here, H in the beginning is just a continuous map, you are interested in knowing if this map is absolutely continuous or not. Which means that if you take the Lebesgue measure here the Lebesgue measure is invariant. So you can push this Lebesgue measure here by this map, and then it's the same as asking if this measure you get is absolutely continuous or not. So yeah. In fact, here is the same question. You take this measure mu A here, for example, which is just mapped by H, and take the Lebesgue measure here. So this is an invariant measure. And the problem is this measure here absolutely continuous or not? So, okay. And of course, let me mention one more thing here, which is quasi-symmetric rigidity. Quasi-symmetric rigidity is something more flexible than C1 rigidity. You could expect this map to be quasi-symmetric rigidity. Quasi-symmetric rigidity holds. In the sense that this map H is quasi-symmetric. So this is also a question. Okay? And here I should emphasize that, for example, since you don't have renormalization, the tool to get this quasi-symmetric rigidity here should be different. In fact, this idea of exactness, it means that you can move to small scale to big scale. It's like a microscope. And this is, of course, a tool to prove quasi-symmetric rigidity, because take interval very small, you can move to big scales, and then it's, of course, this a natural question here, asking about this rigidity here. Yeah? Yes. I'm concentrating this here. Yeah, if this H here is quasi-symmetric or not. And I'm saying that this expansion you have it is, at least in the topological level, is a tool to in that direction. But of course, when you move from small scale to big scale, if you can do this, preserving the distortion, so then that's fine. So then the problem here is to control the distortion of this transport from small scale to big scale. Okay. Okay. In fact, this is, of course, somehow many times related with this. Here you have many invariant contour sets. Okay, many invariant contour sets, and of course, all sort of geometry can happen in these many contour sets you have. But of course, there is a very special contour set in this situation. Sometimes not a contour set, but there is this omega limit set of the critical point, and this is, of course, an important set. Sometimes it can be the whole circle, but sometimes it's a contour set, and then you could ask also if about the geometry of the set. But let me go on in order not to be very vague in this. Let me try to put some. To be more precise, let me keep this drawing here for a while. In fact, let me make another drawing. In fact, I would like to compare a little bit with some other dynamics. Okay. Of course, here there is a very long story, and I'm sorry I will not enter in this story because probably if I enter in this story I will make mistakes. And so let me skip this. But at least let me mention here this other kind of dynamics. There is this what we call the. This critical homeo of the circle. So this is one of the situation Wellington likes, critical homeo. So you have a critical point here. Of course, this is a, let's say, let me point out that this is degree one map. Topological degree is one. And in here, somehow, this critical point helps in the sense of that you have some kind of symmetry here. Symmetry, I mean, is when you look to these two intervals, because you have here this critical point, and of course, the rotation number is irrational. I'm assuming the rotation number is irrational. So then these two sides should be comparable. So this is one case. And of course, there is also this case here, the unimodal case. So it's also a critical point here in the middle. So it's unimodal. And this is the case of degree zero. And here, of course, it's more evident that you have symmetry with respect to the critical point. This is symmetrical behavior here with the respect to the critical point. And the situation I'm considering is the one I call critical curving. And of course, this guy like this, the critical point is in here. So this is the critical curving. And so this is the case of degree two. Degree two. And of course, here, which is not very clear, is if you get symmetrical behavior or not. This question of symmetry here, I think, is an important question. And because as you move to small scale and see the, I will be more clear about this this property later. But the idea is that in this situation, it's more difficult to control the symmetry if it is exists. So this is the reason I'm interested in this thing here, because it looks that it has a new phenomenon to be studied, which is the symmetry with respect to the critical point. Okay. So then there is a long story here. I apologize for not telling this story, but it's a very nice, beautiful story about this. And so going. Okay. And of course, there is one thing here I also should mention, which is the critical order. Critical order, the order of the critical point, call it L. And this, of course, has also a big influence on the dynamics and on the metrical properties. The combinatorics has a lot of influence, but also this order here has an influence. And then let me mention these two situations. The situation I consider today is this order is between 1 and 2, like this, open. Maybe I could put closed here on 2. Maybe I can go a little bit further than 2, but to be safe, let me put like this for today. So, and then in this situation here, in general, you have no what we call bounded geometry. So things degenerate. Even if you consider renormalization with more than one interval, this renormalization is degenerate because the branches get very expanding and the domains goes down very fast. So, and but of course, for L bigger than 2, then we start having some bounded geometry. Depend on the combinatoric you put on the critical point, and you ask L bigger than 2, you may get some bounded combinatoric. So this may hold for some combinatorics. Bounded geometry may hold. Depend on the combinatorics of the critical points. And in fact, maybe I should mention here that if you take L big, so here there is a sorry?
What happens when L is equal to 3?
In general, we also have no bounded for geometry. The geometry degenerates somehow. Yeah, in fact, there is here a special case in which is the case 2, or including 2 here, in the Fibonacci combinatorics. I have a paper with Eduardo Colli showing that the geometry decays fast. And in fact, this was considered before in the new model case by Liubich and Milner, the Fibonacci case, in the quadratic family, in fact. And also the geometry decays fast. Okay. But I would like to mention here, of course, maybe I will mention this later, but if you take L big here, so let's say L very big, you may have more than bounded geometry, you can have a normalization. In fact, you could take L big plus, let's say. Later I will tell you what is Fibonacci. But let's think that you have Fibonacci here for a while. So this is L big plus Fibonacci combinatorics. And so then there is a theorem saying that you have a fixed point for normalization. There is a renormalization, and this renormalization has a fixed point. Okay, in this case, of course, you could be interested in the geometry of the omega limit set. And also in this big, in this case that L is big, and also still with the Fibonacci combinatorics, you could ask about the existence of wide attractor, if there exists so wide counter attractor, and the answer seems to be positive. So although you don't have you may, and of course, this wide counter attractor would be the omega limit set of the critical point. And this is, of course, it was proved some kind of result. Like this was proved first in the context of unimodal map by Sebastian and his co-authors. Okay. And in fact, I have some kind of sad story about this part. I'll not comment here, but there is this kind of result. I'm sorry that I'm going slower than I was planning, but let's try to make things here a little bit more precise and arrive to. Let me at least state here a theorem. In fact, so this is a theorem by together with a student in São Paulo, it's André Alves, myself. This is still in progress, and the theorem is like this. If you take this L between 1 and 2, and you have what I called here generalized Fibonacci combinatorics. Then you have F has an absolute continuous invariant measure. Or if you want that map, the conjugacy is absolutely continuous conjugacy. Okay. Sorry. And here there is this issue here of this non-integer power. It's an important point here. The order is not integer. It means that you cannot use analytical tools. The tools you have your disposal is like expansion of cross ratios and this order on the circle, this kind of thing. Sorry? It should work also for 2 and also for a little bit more than 2, but not for. Uh, We can do it for two. It's in fact already published in the case of Fibonacci combinatorics. It's a paper published some time ago with Edward Qualley. Okay. But let me explain a little bit what is the generalized combinatorics here. Because the point is that some results are known for Fibonacci combinatorics, but the point is that this Fibonacci combinatorics is a very, very nice recursive relation, which makes life easier. Okay? So then the idea is to move to all combinatorics. Okay? And then this here is, let's say, a first step in this direction, moving out from this Fibonacci combinatorics. But so then I'll be more precise about what is this combinatorics and maybe. So let me talk here about this generalized. We call it generalized Fibonacci here. So what is this? This is just something here. First of all, you ask the critical point to be recurrent, okay? Critical point is in the omega limit set, set of itself, and because of this, of course, you have what we call principal nest. Principal nest. There exists this principal nest, which is just a sequence of intervals. We start with interval I naught, which is you can think this is the whole interval, 0, 1. And then we have a sequence of intervals here going down, shrinking to the critical point. Okay? And these intervals, they are defined like this. By induction, you start with this interval here, and the I1, so then you just do like this. I1 plus 1. It's kind of first return domain to the previous one. You have the previous domain here, which is IN, and you have a first return map here, and this is just a branch of this first return map. I call this branch phi N plus 1. So this is a first return. Okay? So this is the way the principal nest is defined. Okay. Okay. And then, so this one now two. So then I ask here something like this. If you look to the image of the critical point, so this image is inside IN, but not inside IN plus 1. Okay? Not inside IN plus 1. So it means non-central. We call it non-central. Non-central returns. Okay? Let me make a drawing here. So suppose here we have the interval IN. Somewhere inside you have this IN plus 1 here around the critical point, C. And then here you have this map, which is called phi N plus 1. And it moves the critical point outside here. Okay. And of course, in this situation, you have a piece, here you have a piece of this IN plus 1, a piece here, which moves in IN plus 1 again. So I call this piece here MN plus 2. Okay? So this it is defined like this. If you take the map phi n minus 1, phi n plus 1 in this MN plus 2, it apply on IN plus 1. Okay? And this is, in this case here, you have no critical point. It's kind of diffeo. Okay. And this is, in fact, if you look here in the previous level, you have this Mn plus 1 here. And the critical point gets here inside. Critical points get here inside. And in the Fibonacci case, it will come back right away to here. So this would be the Fibonacci case. Okay? But in this case, I called generalized Fibonacci. It stay here for a while and then come back. So and this is already enough to make recursive relations more complicated, okay? And this is a kind of starting point to consider some other combinatorics. Okay. In fact, this is the, let me finish here with this third property, which is this. So phi n plus 1 c is in fact not, it's not necessary to put c here now. Yeah. In fact, you should put this Mn plus 1. And the map phi n plus 2 is just like you take this phi n plus 1. So then you move outside, and then you compose with some finite number of times this phi n, and then you come back. So this kn here is something bigger or equal than 1. So this is the definition of generalized Fibonacci. In fact, the case kn is 1 is the Fibonacci case. So and then so I consider here the situation. In this situation, there's the, for example, in this kind of situation, the omega limit set of the critical point is a minimal Cantor set. Minimal Cantor set. In this situation, you have this observation that if you take the omega limit set of the critical point is minimal invariant Cantor set. You could look for the geometry of the set. Let me erase the theorem already. So I suppose I have more 10 minutes or so. 8, okay. So then this is definition and and in fact, there are many results about this omega limit set, the geometry of this omega limit set in the case of Fibonacci, in the case of unimodal maps, which is related. But in the situation that the critical order is 2, and also for a very big critical order. Let me try to move a little bit faster here. Okay. So this discussion, let me try to give some hints about the proof, how to solve this, to prove the existence of the absolute continuous invariant measure. So in fact, let me try to put it in steps. So the first climb here is that in the situation I'm considering, the order is between 1 and 2. It's not the most general situation. I think it can be more general than this. But let me discuss the situation. So the climb here is that if you look to this derivative here on the critical value, it grows. And in fact, it should grow very fast. And then if you have this, there is a result by Sebastian von Strien, Letelier, I think also Bruin, and Shane, showing that this implies that you have an absolutely continuous Orange measure, and also that the H is quasi the homeomorphism H is also absolutely continuous. Then I'll try to explain a little bit how to prove this thing here. Okay. In fact, what we prove is not this one. We concentrate on the first return times. First return times, let me introduce here some notation. So you have this map phi n. So this map phi n is in fact a first return map. You can write this as FSN. So the SN here is a first return time of the critical point near itself. Okay? So this SN is the definition of SN here. And also, there is something important in this proof, which is this. You have here, so this is the critical the image of the critical point at the time Sn, and then you should take in consideration how far it is from the critical point. So this is a parameter which is important here. I denote it by dn. And sometimes we need to consider this not around the critical point, but around the critical value. So then you map by f, and you get what we call dnf. So f here upstairs means that you map by f. So it's just snf here, and cf is the critical value. So this is parameters that will appear in the idea. And in fact, here there is, in fact, let me make a drawing here. So this is something like this. You have here I n minus 1. Here you have IN, IN, and then you have your map, phi n here. So then here is this guy I'm calling CSN. And the distance dn is this distance here. Okay. In fact, there is. Let me continue it a little bit more with this picture. Next level, you have a branch here, which is IN plus 1. And you have a. So, in fact, we have these guys I called MN plus 1 here. You have this. Oh, no, this is here, like this. And then you have the next one here. Mn plus 1 here, and then you move, you stay some time here, and then you move here. And later you stay some time here and move here. So it means that if you compare this guy here, which is Tn dn plus 2, which is this guy here, and this guy, dn, so if you take this quotient here, n plus 2, because of a priori bounds, you have a priori bounds, this guy is bounded away from 1. There's a constant here, it's bigger than 1. This is very important. But here, the asymmetrical behavior may may makes your life a little bit more difficult, because if you want to compare dn with dn plus 1, so this will be a problem. So you have to do something. So this kind of problem does not appear if you consider the unimodal case. So, but what we do, in fact, is not to prove this. This will be proved later. First, we prove this here. Take the derivative of this time Sn. And to estimate this here, you need to consider a cross-ratio expansions. And in fact, here we consider this variable here, which is Xn, which is log of dfsn cf. And we want to prove that this grows at least linearly. Okay? So, and in fact, using this cross ratio, you can prove kind of a difference equation. Let me write the difference equation you prove. So to get this difference equation, you need to prove 1 minute, okay? Difference equation, you need to prove, of course, you need to use here chain rule, this kind of thing. But you also need to use cross-ratio expansion. And then an equation like this. Xn plus 1 is bigger than 1 half Xn plus 1 half Xn minus 1. And then we get some term here which is not very bad, because they are bounded. They come from distortion. Distortion is somehow controlled by Hilbert. These are bound guys, and no problem. And then we get some term here which is good. So this is where the order appears. The order appears here is 2 minus L. Minus L. So this proof would not work for L equal to 2 because of this guy here multiplying log of that quotient there. So the quotient here is d1 minus 1 over dn plus 1. So this in this case, is a constant bigger than 0. This is good. This is good. And of course, there is also another part which is not very good, which comes from asymmetrical behavior, which is something like log of this d1 minus 1 over dn. So this is bad, because if this is positive, OK. But this, because of asymmetrical behavior, this could be negative. And then this will spoil it down. The argument here. So in fact, maybe I should stop here, but in fact, this problem of asymmetric behavior here, we can solve it somehow easily if you, instead of this, take two times this, and then can solve that. But then some other problems appear. And OK, let me stop here.